And with that, it's time for the final Friday night analysis of Shields and Brooks. That is syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. And before I go any further, I want to make it clear, Mark will continue to be a part of the NewsHour family as an occasional contributor. We're going to have him back when there's a major political event or anything else that he wants to weigh in on. But Mark, before I let you and David speak, I want to say what an utter joy it has been for me to work with you over the years, to be the beneficiary, along with our audience, of your wisdom, your brilliant insights, and as we heard in that video, your humor. I know our founder, Jim Lehrer, adored and appreciated you. We've all learned from you. It is impossible to put it into a few words, but the entire NewsHour family owes you a great debt of gratitude. We are going to miss having you with us every week. And now I'm going to let you speak. So, Mark, what did you think about the video?
Judy, it was like reading David's column, his generous column. I just regretted that my parents weren't alive to read it and enjoy it, because my father would have enjoyed it and my mother would have wanted to believe it. And I just thank everybody for their over the top and too generous remarks. It's been 33 wonderful years. It's been a great privilege, and it's been just enormous fun. You shouldn't admit that, but that's what it's been.
And David, what do you think? Did you hear anything that rang true to you there?
Everyone knows the same Mark. Mark is Mark. When he called to tell me the news a couple of weeks ago, I told him the blunt truth. Mark is the best colleague I've ever had at any level of journalism or in any line of work. I've never been around somebody who generates just so much warmth, who treats everybody with so much respect. I figure, we haven't talked about this, Mark, but I figure your parents loved you really well when you were a kid, and you've been sharing it with the rest of us in the years since, because you just walk in a room with a projection of warmth and respect that people respond to. In that little column I wrote about you, it was the number one viewed site piece on the site, New York Times site today, because people want this. People are hungering for trustworthiness and decency. And it's been a great blessing of my life to be alongside you for the last 19 years of this.
Thank you, David.
And Mark, we're sharing all this with you because it's all true. But I know there's something that you want to say tonight, because you've spent all these years thinking a lot about American politics and about this country. So I want to give you a chance to talk about it.
Oh, that's kind of you, Judy. Thank you, David. I have to say, David has been the most generous and ideal of partners for the past 19 years. Judy asked once at Thanksgiving what I was thankful for, and one of the things I listed was that during all the time together, I'd said some dumb, stupid, and probably just absolutely inappropriate things, and never once did David Brooks take a cheap shot, because it's not in him, it's not in his character. And he's been a source of great company. He's been a source of great wisdom. He's my friend, and I treasure him. So I thank you for those kind remarks. I grew up when a man was in the White House who said very simply, "The measure of our progress is not whether we add more to the abundance of those who have much, but whether we provide enough for those who have too little." It's a very straightforward, as Franklin Roosevelt. And the other kind of guidepost for me in politics that I guess I learned from my mom and my dad, my family, was that every one of us has been warmed by fires we did not build. And every one of us has drunk from wells we did not dig. And together, we can't do less for those who come after us. And together, we can do so much more. And it's as straightforward as that. I believe politics is the peaceable resolution of conflict among legitimate competing interests. And I don't know in a nation as big and brawling, this great continent which we occupy and diverse as ours, how it would resolve our differences except through the commitment, the passion, the intelligence, the courage of those who are willing to practice the political process. and achieve compromise. The fashion of those compromises does require courage, and it does require hard work and intelligence. So I like people who run for political office. It puts me in a very small category. The example I use is if David and I were, I like people who run for office. And if David and I were the two finalists to be the regional sales manager of the Acme windshield wiper company, and David rightly got the promotion and I didn't, when the hometown paper announced David's success, they wouldn't add that Shields was passed over because of lingering questions about his expense account or his erratic behavior at the company Christmas party. But in politics, when you run for office, everybody you ever sat next to in study hall or double dated with or babysat knows whether you won or you probably lost. And, I respect and admire those who run and lose, and nobody ever did it better than an old friend of mine, the late Dick Tuck, who lost a very close state Senate race in Los Angeles. And when the local announcer stuck a microphone in his face to say something, he said very straightforwardly, "The people have spoken, the bastards." But I mean, that's so it's a tough, it's a tough business. It is wonderful. There's nothing more fun than a political campaign. I urge everybody who hasn't been involved in one to carve it out of their schedule and try and do so, because you get all these people submerging their own particular short-term interest to something larger, and working long hours at dislocation to their personal and professional lives. And on one 12-hour period, elections have been rightly called a one-day sale. You find out whether you won or you lost, you will forge friendships and relationships that will last a lifetime. I like politics. I believe in politics. I think politics is awfully important to the well-being of our nation.
And Mark, one of the things David wrote about you in his column today is that there's this basic trust or basic decency that you believe exists in people who serve in public life. I think right now there's a lack of faith that's there. So I'm curious, as you take this next step in your life, are you optimistic about the country, about what lies ahead? What do you see?
Well, I think optimism is the defining characteristic of America. I mean, with the exception of those whose ancestors were here when Columbus arrived, or those whose ancestors were brought here against their will and chains, every American is either himself or herself an immigrant or the direct lineal descendants of immigrants. And to leave, friends and family and familiar surroundings to strike out across the sea or the continent to a place you've never been, to live among people you've never met, to speak a language in many cases you've never heard, is an act of enormous courage. But it's also a statement of profound optimism. And America was found and continues to be founded on a daily basis by optimism. I'm not a Pollyanna. I know that we were all born in original sin and we're capable of just dastardly things, personally and collectively. But when asked by our leaders, and have leaders who reach out to our best and ask us for collective sacrifice for the common good, Americans have responded rather remarkably. I recall when John Kennedy was president and proposed the Peace Corps, and one young man was volunteering and they asked him why. And he said, nobody ever asked me to do anything unselfish or patriotic. And President Kennedy asked me. And I think when Americans are asked, I think I'm optimistic about Joe Biden because he's not a wall builder, he's a bridge builder. He's somebody who extends that hand of friendship. We'll find out if the folks on the other side of the bridge will come a third across or halfway across. I'm hopeful. I really am. We've done great things. We've done great things, Judy. I mean, we've saved the Great Lakes. We've taken lead out of the air. I mean, we've done wonderful things. We rebuilt a war-torn Europe. We have, and we ought to be aware of that.
As we continue this conversation, Mark, and I bring David in, I also want to ask the love of your life, Ann Shields, who I think is nearby. The two of you celebrated your 54th wedding anniversary yesterday. Ann, she's coming in right now. She's going to take her place next to Mark. Important. We're making room for her. David, I want you to reflect a little more on what this means as we say goodbye to Mark on Fridays.
First, I want to say I've been, I think, extremely highly of Mark. He's a wonderful guy, as I've said. He nevertheless still set the world record for marrying up. So I pay tribute to Anne, who's a truly remarkable person. I would say that Mark is, like all of us, we're formed by a certain era. And in Mark's case, it was the period, I think, when he was a Hill staffer in the mid-60s. And look, government was working. The GI Bill had worked. The Civil Rights Act, the Voting Rights Act, the Fair Housing Act, government was doing a lot of stuff. People were compromising. The system was working. And so you had a sense that this was a noble activity. Politics and the power involved in it is a means to an end, and the end is comforting the unfortunate, serving the marginalized, waging a war on poverty. And so you had the sense that this is not just some game. This is a noble profession because it's about achieving noble ends for people who need a hand up. And so with that came a feeling that you were there to serve the underdogs. With that came a deep sense of equality. I was a kid who had Hubert Humphrey's poster on my wall, who Mark probably knew. So that was inspiring. It's a more morally holistic way to think of politics. And I speak to young people, and that all they've known is broken politics. And I tried to assure them it wasn't always broken. And that there's a way to bring it back so it's not broken again. We go through cycles and we'll come back and fix the politics that broken. But Mark just comes for that era, like his neckties, neck, come to think of it.
We hope the broken politics are not behind us. Mark reminds us that everything good is possible in the future. And as we say goodbye to Mark and to Ann Shields on this Friday night, I just want to express to you what you've meant, Mark, again, to us and to our audience. We have received thousands of comments, literally, since we announced earlier this week that this would be your last Friday night. But I want to stress again, you're going to continue to show up on our air when important things happen. So you leave with our love and our affection and our eternal gratitude. Mark Shields, there with the love of his life, Ann Shields and David Brooks. Thank you.
Thank you, Judy. Thanks, you, David.
Judy.
Thanks.
See you, Mark.
See you, David.